morning, St. Andrew's Church. You know, we're so glad to be here on this beautiful day. We have a lot of people out as they are preparing for our church-wide picnic this morning. We hope to see all of you. Welcome to all of you online. It's a glorious day and a wonderful day to praise God. Please stand with us. I saw Satan fall like lightning. Yeah. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. Yeah. I believe in signs and wonders. Yes, I do, yeah. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. Oh, my praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. A testimony. Come together, sons and daughters, yeah. Bought with blood and washed in water. Mm-hmm. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Yeah. Our God will finish what He started. This is my testimony. From death to life, 'cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe I'm not dead. You're not done. You're not done with me, Lord. Yeah. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe I'm not dead. You're not done. Yeah, yeah. Greater things are still to come. Testimony from death to life, 'cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. We have quite a few people that are going to be baptized today. And I just want us all that are here and gathered online to just keep them in prayer. If you've been baptized, you remember what that day was like. I know for me, it was life-changing. It was transforming. And I felt the presence at that moment. I felt the presence of the Holy Spirit. And that's what we pray for all of these people that will be baptized today, that they would sense and be aware of the Holy Spirit, that Spirit that comforts them, that guides them, that is with them as they walk in all of the days that the Lord has for them, that they would come to know Him intimately, that they would know Him completely, that they would fall in love with Him, that they would follow Him. Lord, Father God, bless these who will be calling You their Lord and Savior today on this special day. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Yeah. Come rest on us. Come down. Spirit, when You move, You make my heart. When You fill the room, You're here and I know You are moving. I'm here and I know You will fill me. Calm down, Spirit, when You move, You make my heart pound. When You fill the room, You're here and I know You are moving. I'm here and I know You will fill me.
I know You are moving. I'm here and I know You are moving.
is you, God. Yes. Oh, yes. You alone, Father God, are worthy of our praise. You alone, Father God, are worthy of our worship, Lord God. We hold nothing back. You know every part of us, Father God. You are Lord of our minds, of our heart, of our moves. Father God, let us bless you this morning, Father, with our desire to worship you, Lord, fully and completely. We praise you, God.
Beside you, hope in all my living one.
Father God, we praise you, Lord. Father God, we thank you for this glorious day. All this is for you. You are the center of everything that we do. In the name of Jesus, we praise you. We worship you. And all his church said, amen. You may be seated, and please welcome Miss Natalie.
St. Andrews, it's Miss Natalie, and I'm coming to you on video message this morning because I am at the river getting all prepared for all of those in our church family that are coming out for our church picnic today. So hope to see you guys there. We've been working hard and we're super excited. So speaking of, today's message is a lot about preparing. And so I wanted to tell you a quick fact, something I found out as I was doing some research for today's lesson about preparation. So imagine back in biblical times, the king is going on a journey and needing to travel on the roads back then. They would send out people to go before them to prepare the roads. And so back then they didn't have paved roads like we do now and highways and easy ways to get from one place to the other. Instead, they might find obstacles on the road, like a big boulder or a hole of some sort, or things that they needed to move out of the way so that when the king came, that road would be prepared and easier for him to go on his travels. So their job was to prepare the way for the king. Well, there's somebody else in scripture that we read about. And I want you to see if you can think about whose job it was to prepare the way for the one true king. Can you think of who the one true king is? I bet you can. Jesus. That's right. Jesus, the one true king. And so someone in the Bible, his job was to prepare the way for that king. And back in Isaiah, so Isaiah is in the Old Testament. So kids, that's the part that comes before Jesus. God's always had the plan to send Jesus. And in Isaiah, he says, Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3, listen, it's the voice of someone shouting, clear the way through the wilderness for the Lord. Make straight a highway through the wasteland for our God. Fill in the valleys and level the mountains and hills, straighten the curves and smooth out the rough places. Then the glory of the Lord will be revealed and all the people will see it together, and the Lord has spoken. So that's way before Jesus is even born. They're already talking about preparing the way. And so God calls a special person, Jesus's cousin actually, John the Baptist, and it is his job, his calling on his life, is to prepare the way for Jesus and the ministry that Jesus would do. As a matter of fact, in your kids' Bible, I'm in Matthew 3, and right there, the title of that chapter says, John the Baptist prepares the way. And so John the Baptist was preparing, actually, not roads, no, not in that sense, but he was preparing people's hearts to hear the message that Jesus was going to be preaching and teaching and living out in those days. So John the Baptist was telling people to repent, which we know means to turn away from sin. So prepare. When you think about preparing, and I think about it for my kids, when they know that a new sport is about to start, they start preparing. They're practicing. They know they're going to have to try out. So once you get into the big kids' schools, you've got to try out for sports. They're practicing. They want all the gear that they need. They are preparing themselves. If you have a test or a quiz, what do? Do you study those spelling words beforehand? Yeah, it feels so good to be prepared for something. And so God used John the Baptist as a special messenger. He was giving people the chance to turn away from sin, to repent is the word that John the Baptist uses, and the Bible will say that he said, repent of your sins, turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. And so he is talking about, it says the prophet Isaiah was speaking about John. Wait, Isaiah, that was way back here in the Old Testament that we just read. In Matthew, it says, he is the voice shouting in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord's coming, clear the road for him. So I want you to think about this today. Are you preparing your heart for Jesus? Are you talking to him? Are you asking for forgiveness when you know that you are doing something that is a sin that breaks his heart? We have to prepare our hearts. So John the Baptist is not here to holler at us and to tell us to turn from our sins, to repent of our sins, to ask for forgiveness. That's something that we have to do. We can read God's word, plant those seeds in our heart, and have our hearts be prepared to meet Jesus every single day. So today's message is about someone who is calling for us to prepare because Jesus is coming. Are you preparing your heart to hear from him? So today, that's what we're going to pray for. Will you pray for me? Lord, we thank you so much for your word has always been promising us of Jesus who came to save us. Help us to be prepared in our hearts for you, Lord. Help us to remember to talk to you and to turn away from our sins so that we can be closer and closer to you each day and hear even more clearly what you would have us do. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. Amen. Well, on this wonderful Sunday morning, we invite you all to pass the peace and tell each other good morning. We sure are glad that you're here, and we hope to see people at the picnic later. Bye.
As we continue on in worship, could you take a look at the screen and greet Scott and Sarah Lambie, the founders of Rescue One More, a ministry partner of St. Andrew's Church in Uganda. They're coming here on October 13th, and here's a little thing they'd like to tell you.
Hey there, St. Andrew's Church. My name is Scott Lambie. This is my wife, Sarah, and we are the founders of Rescue One More. It's an organization based in Uganda, and we provide safety, justice, and healing to children who are experiencing sexual violence. We're heading your way on October 13th, and we'll be at St. Andrew's, and we're looking forward to meeting you.
We were so excited to have Wink and Glenn and Leanne and Maddie come join us this summer and minister to the children in our program and to our team. And we just cannot wait to share with you all more about our work and about the work that God is doing through the church.
It's a big problem, and we believe that God can move this mountain through the church. And so we're grateful to St. Andrew's for being one of those churches that is willing to raise their hand and join hands with us. So see you soon.
Besides being presented in the church services, we're having a luncheon afterwards on the 13th at La Fonda Alamo Heights back in the party room, and where they're going to do a full presentation where you can ask questions. It's an incredible ministry that's truly changing a culture, which is what the kingdom of God is supposed to do. It's amazing, this work and this ministry. So. It's a private room, so the seating is limited. We've got some slots left. If you'd like to, please contact us at missions@standrews09.org, and we'll save a place for you. But we look forward to seeing you there on October 13th.
Awesome. Let us continue our worship. Please stand. Let us open our hearts and just give our awesome God, our Lord and Savior, all of our gratitude.
All my words fall short. I've got nothing new. How could I express all my would sing these songs as I often do. But every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands, praise you again and again, 'cause all that
just one move with my arms just wide. I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all
see. Good morning, everybody. I want to take a second to look into the lens, say good morning to all of you watching online. Thanks for joining with us on this wonderful Sunday morning. To those of you in house, good morning, church. Wow. I mean, I know I haven't done my thing in a while, but still, y'all are way out of practice. So it is exciting. It's a great day. I'm doing a different take today of what I was planning on doing, a letter to Paul. But I shifted and changed because of what's happening later this afternoon in just a couple of hours. And today is church picnic day, everybody. Woo, yeah, come on. How many of you are going to the picnic? Yeah, okay, good. All right, I love it. It's gonna be a great time. We're baptizing 17 people. Yeah, 17. Hey, this arm's gonna be huge by the time you bring it down, bring it back up, doing all that stuff. It's gonna be great. There's a set of twins, and their mama said, "Would you hold them under a little bit longer?" And I'm like, "One of them, I'm gonna hold under longer. Like, get down there, Bobby, and get the evil out of you, right?" But it's gonna be exciting. Next week, we're gonna start a new series, and it's called Tomorrow: Living in a World of Uncertainty. Yeah, there's no uncertainty going on in our world, but I'm going to do a four-part series. We're going to go OT on you, get a little Old Testament up in here for a few Sundays, and it's going to be exciting. But today I'm going to do a sermon based on what's coming. And Miss Natalie, you know, this is why I don't like the 9:30 and 11 o'clock as much, because sometimes the way I open at 9:15 loses all its power because of the power of Miss Natalie. Because she goes before me and she reveals what I'm going to talk about. So if I ask you a question, you already kind of know. But maybe not. Here's the thing. I don't know if you know what happens in my head all the time, but there's like 5 conversations going on in my head at all times. Right now, I'm having a conversation of like, "Oh, I haven't seen her in a while. That's good to see you. Wait, welcome back into town," you know, and such things. While I'm trying to also talk to you, it's really hard to be up here. But there was a question that kind of appeared during this week as I was thinking about what I was going to do on Sunday. And it was, why 30? That was the question. Why 30? Why 30? It's like, what do you mean? What do you mean, why 30? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Why did Jesus come at age 30? What was it about that age? And we can do air quotes, 30, because it was 30-ish, más o menos, right? Why? What was so special and significant? Some of you have already made it through how many of you remember when you were 30? Yeah, that got a big laugh down the hall. They're like, "Well, I don't remember that at all." How many of you remember when you were 30? What was it significant about your 30? Remember when you get into your 30s? Like, when you're still in your 20s, you're an adult, but no one treats you like it. All of a sudden at 30, people are like, "Well, maybe you're a little bit more of an adult," right? And there's almost this sense, because a lot of us were married at that time, maybe we have a child at that time, something like that, that you're starting to shift into a different stage of life. But Jesus wasn't married. I don't care what the Da Vinci Code says. He wasn't. He didn't have kids. Why 30? Have any of you ever thought of that? Has that question ever like crossed your minds? Like, what was it about that moment in time that 30 was significant? Because if we know the story of Jesus, and if you know it, there's some stuff that's written about him before 30, right? We know his conception story, right? You know, we know that whole thing. We know when Mary goes and she visits her cousin, and his cousin leaps in the womb when she just enters the room, right? And it's like, okay, there's something different about him. There's something big. And then we know the birth story that we tell every Christmas, and it's so sweet and wonderful and really stinky and terrible at the same time, the manger scene and all of that stuff. And then we know the 3 wise men who come and they appear and they deliver gifts, and then they have to flee and go to Egypt. Remember that? Like Jesus and Mary and Joseph, they get out of Dodge and they go to Egypt because Herod is after them, but then they come back. We know the circumcision story of when Jesus is presented at the temple. And they circumcise and they give him his name, which is the historical Jewish tradition, what you would do. And you have these 2 elderly folks who see Jesus and they're like, "Gosh, we know who you are." And they reveal this to Mary in this beautiful, sweet, and also terrible moment at the same time, really. This great story there. Then you have the story that is one of my favorites, and it makes me feel like the best parent ever. It's the story of when Mary and Joseph lost Jesus for 3 days. Y'all remember this story? And how many of you, when you remember that story, are like, "Man, I've never lost my kid for even a day. I feel so much better than them." You know, and they lost him for 3 days, right? They've been in Jerusalem. They've left Jerusalem. They've traveled for 3 days, and Mary goes to Joseph, "Hey, where's Jesus?" He goes, I thought he was with you. You know, "Where is he?" They've lost him. They have to go back into Jerusalem, and they find him in the temple, and he's like, "Woman, where'd you think I'd be? I'm in my father's house," right? He kind of slaps her around a little bit, but we have those stories, and We don't have much else. Like, we know he grew up in a community. We know that he had a father who was known in what he did, right? Because later he's called that carpenter's boy. We know that he did have an earthly father. We don't know what happened to his earthly father. Just at one point, he just disappears from the story. We know that Jesus had siblings. We know that he had brothers, specifically James and Jude, who are probably the most famous. But we also know that he had sisters from Scripture, because it talks about them coming in to meet Jesus. We don't know their names, but we know some things about him. But why 30? Like, what was it about that moment of time that it was like, all right, it's go time? I think in order to understand it, you have to go back to what Miss Natalie was talking about, and the guy who first kind of understood who Jesus was, even though he was still in the womb, his cousin, John the Baptist, or as we like to call him around here, JTB. Now, JTB is very significant in this because there's a couple of stories about him throughout the gospel narratives. We hear about his story up until the point where he's executed. But JTB was, most scholars would agree that he was an Essene. And an Essene is, you've heard of the Pharisees, you've heard of the Sadducees. An Essene was another religious sect of Judaism. And it was a group of people who believed if you got enough people together who lived and followed the 613 laws of the Old Testament closely enough, that God would send the Messiah. Like, they secluded themselves from the rest of the world, and they lived in a community, and they said, if we follow these 613 laws, remember, they didn't have cheeseburgers, is what I'm trying to say, right? If they followed these 613 laws closely enough, then maybe God would finally send the Messiah that people had been waiting for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. Maybe that would be it. So he lived his life with the Essenes, and the Essenes were hardcore. I mean, already, if you're saying, I'm going to follow these 613 laws, it's hardcore. But they lived, and John is described in the Gospel of Matthew as one who wears camel's hair. And it's not what you're thinking of in December when all of you start breaking out your camel's hair coats. That's not what it is. It's a rough thing. It says he ate locusts and honey. Like, yum, right? That's Whataburger's new burger, locusts and honey. Some people would say it could be the bugs, locusts. Others say there was a flower that was also called locust. And so which one was it? Was he just a vegetarian or did he eat bugs? I don't know. I prefer to think of him as a bug eater because that makes him a little bit more hardcore. But they lived in this community down around the Dead Sea, along the Jordan River. There were a bunch of areas, but we know specifically that this is one area, and it's very close to where John was baptizing people. It's called a community called Qumran. Anyone ever heard of it? Anybody know why it's famous? I bet you know. You just don't know. The Dead Sea Scrolls. Has anyone ever heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls? They were found in the community of Qumran. And the Dead Sea Scrolls are this, there's this shepherd boy back in the 1950s, I believe it was, 54, I think. And he's got his sheep around this area, and he's bored, and he's throwing rocks into caves, as kids do. And he's throwing rocks, and he hears sound after sound, and then he hears this chink. It's a different sound, and he's like, well, that's weird. So he crawls up into the cave, and he looks, and he finds this clay jar that he had shattered, actually, and in this clay jar was a scroll. And he goes and he tells people about it, and they do this huge archaeological dig, and they find all of these scrolls of Scripture. In fact, the longest one they have is the complete Isaiah. All of Isaiah is in one complete, really long scroll. And then they have all these different fragments of different Scripture, because what the Essenes did in living these 613 laws, one of the things they did is they copied Scripture. They wanted to ensure that Scripture would be around for people to read. And so there would be groups of these people. You would have three people who would write Scripture. And there would be three people, say it's the three of us right here. And we would go up to, and I would be the scribe. We would go cleanse ourselves. So we would do this practice called mikvah. We would go to a source of living water, and we would do mikvah. And we would put water. It sometimes it would be submersible, but not all the time. You do water on your head, on your mouth, on your heart, on your hands, and on your feet. And it was to clean my thoughts, my words, my will, my actions, and my path. to make myself ceremonially clean to enter into a space. And we would go and we would write. And I would write the first word, and you would check it, and you'd say, yes, that looks good. And you would check it, and you'd say, yes, that looks good with the original up top, and then here's the new one. And we would do word after word after word. When we would get to the name of God, Yahweh, the first letter is a yid, a Y. We would stop. We would get up. We would go do mikvah again. We would cleanse ourselves and make ourselves ceremonially clean so that we could come back into this place. And I would write the Y, and I would say, is that a Y? Is that a Y? We'd say, we'd all agree. We would stop again, and we would go do mikvah again so that we could do the next letter. And you would do this through the four different letters that make up Yahweh in the Hebrew language, because there was a reverence around that name. But this practice of mikvah, John would have grown up knowing this. He would have known this practice. He would have grown up because remember who his dad was? He was a priest, Zechariah. And priests were the ones who led people in this kind of cleansing ritual. Priests were the ones who taught you, this is how you ceremonially wash your hands before you go to the Seder meal. This is how you ceremonially cleanse utensils and so you, that you can bring them into this place. This is how you ceremonially clean yourself so that you can enter into the presence of God. See, from the very beginning of John's life, his father, Zechariah, had been pouring into him, you have to prepare yourself to enter into a sacred space. John grows up to be JTB. And JTB takes a practice that was never used by Jews and began to use it along the lines of this mikveh, but he changed it a little bit. Actually, he changed it quite significantly. Because what Zechariah had taught John was that you need to become ceremonially clean to enter into a space. And what John began to do was to say, no. You need to be clean to enter into a life. So what John was doing and what John changed was he took this idea of mikveh that Jews were very familiar with, and he grabbed hold of this idea of baptism that Jews would have been familiar with, but they never would have done, because baptism was for those outside the faith. Baptism was for those who were so unclean because they were pagan, they were Gentile. Jews were part of the family of God. We're the chosen ones. We don't have to go to that extreme. We just have to cleanse ourselves so that we can enter into a space. But John's saying, no, but the way you're living is wrong. In fact, his word was repent, right? He was calling people to a baptism of repentance. And what repentance means, it means literally to turn from this way and go that way. It means to turn from the way that you're going and turn to the way you should be going. What John was doing is turn from the way of the world and turn back to the way of God. He was bringing forth this kind of pagan ritual, what they would do with pagans, and saying, no, we need to do this. We have been following the ways of the synagogue and the temple, and most specifically, he points out, the Pharisees, and we need to stop. And so he would do this ritual thing, this ceremony that said when you go underwater, you're dropping off, you're washing off the old harmful ways of life, and you're stepping into a new life. Repent, he would cry out, repent. And boy, what he was doing caught fire. What he was doing out there in the wilderness at the Jordan River became huge, so much so that you see in the Gospel of John that the Pharisees, the leaders of the synagogue and the temple, were sending out spies to see what he's doing and to ask him questions, to interview him. Like, who are you? JTB goes, man, I'm not the Messiah, but I know who he is. I'm out here because he's going to come. In fact, he says this, I'm baptizing with water so that he might be revealed. See, I think JTB knew his place. In fact, he says it in the Gospel of Matthew that this is who I am. I'm the one preparing the way in the wilderness. He's out in the wilderness, and what he's doing is he says in John, like, I'm doing this so that when he comes, we all go, oh, that's him. That's him. Repent. And then so Jesus comes. Jesus comes. And this is the crazy thing, right? Because what John is doing is John is calling everyone, all these Jews, to say, hey, the way you're living your life is wrong. Die to that way and step into this new way. And then Jesus comes and John's like, whoa. First he says, behold, here comes the Lamb of God. He's like, I can't baptize you. You're not walking the wrong way. Like, I've known who you were since I was in my mommy's tummy. I can't turn away. I'm not worthy, he says, to even untie the strap of your sandal. But remember what Jesus says? He's like, look, man, you got to baptize me to fulfill all righteousness. And so John, when confronted with that, was like, okay. I mean, what do you do when the Messiah tells you to do something? You do it. You should. I guess I haven't done it all the time, but that always shows up poorly. So he baptizes him. And this is what happens. It's so cool. See, I think that Jesus came at this moment because there was enough movement in the people of Israel, because God is the one who said it is from Israel that the Messiah would come. It is from Israel that my message will spread throughout the world. It is from that chosen people, the Jews, that the early church was birthed and it began to catch fire and take over the rest of the world. It was those people. And there was a moment right then when Jesus turns 30-ish that John the Baptist is out in the wilderness and he's catching fire and people are starting to get it and they're starting to turn away from the religious leaders of the day and say, no, there is a new way. John is inviting people to say no to the old way of life and step into a sacred new life. And so Jesus comes out into the wilderness and he's like, hey, I need to be baptized. And John's like, no, you don't. I know who you are. And Jesus says, let's do this. And then there's something magical that happens, something amazing. It's in Matthew chapter 3. After his baptism, so John takes him down into the water and he comes up. As Jesus comes up out of the water, the heavens were opened and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son whom I love. Now, this is a super powerful moment in Scripture because it is from this moment everything else happens. Everything else happens. Why? It's because of what would happen. This is the first time in Scripture that the Trinity is together in one place. Now, we have mention of the Father, of the Son, of the Spirit, and sometimes two of them are together, but this is the first time that all three of them are together in one spot. It's in this moment, when the Spirit descends in the form of a dove, when the Son comes out of the water and the Father speaks. And boy, what the Father says is important. What the Father says is important because up until this time, we have all these beautiful, wonderful stories of Jesus, but he doesn't do anything significant. It's after this. And look, let's not kid ourselves. Jesus always knew who he was. Why? Well, because of how John begins his story. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus being the Word. Jesus always knew who he was, but it was this moment when something significant happens. It's this identity placed on him. It's this identity. It's the Father speaking out so that everyone can hear, this is my Son, whom I love. This is my Son. This is my Son. You know what? Every baptism, there's identity that's put on that person. Every time I baptize a baby up here and I pour the water over their head, we may not hear it, but the voice of God is saying, this is my daughter whom I love. Today when I'm at the river and I'm gonna be baptized a whole bunch of people, every time I pull somebody out of that water, the voice of God is gonna be saying, this is my Son whom I love. Something so powerful that was going on in this moment. The Holy Spirit descends, and it's this showing of, like, there's going to be one, and Jesus is going to say later, like, I'm going to send the Spirit so that you do greater things even than I have done. But did you see how this powerful entity descends? It descends in the form of a sign of peace. It doesn't come in the sign of some symbol of war like an eagle. You would think it would come in like some big old hawk or eagle, like, coming down like that. But no. It descends in the form of a dove. The sign of peace. Because from the very beginning, from this moment, God and Jesus and the Spirit are calling the shot. Because what God says is hugely significant. See, God, when he speaks these words, he's quoting from a psalm that points to who the Messiah would be, but he's also grabbing from the book of Isaiah that says the Messiah will be a suffering servant. So what God is doing in this moment of baptism is reminding Jesus and putting this identity, Jesus, that you are going to be the one who saves everyone, but your throne is going to be a cross. From that moment, Jesus takes off. And 3 years later, he gets on his throne and he conquers death. Every time there's baptism, there's identity. Every time. Every time. Now, you may have come from a different background. I grew up as an Episcopalian, became a Methodist pastor. I'm informed greatly by those traditions. John Wesley called baptism an outward sign of an inward and spiritual grace. I love that. It's beautiful language. And some people don't agree with baptizing babies. I can make a case scripturally that they did it in the early church. And it's not necessarily important for that child to know at that moment that the identity of a son or a daughter of God has been placed on them. For that child, it's important for their parents to know it and to call it out of them every day of their life. For those children who are baptized as babies, it's like, no, this is who you are. This is who you are. Hey, parents, have you ever had a child that did something wrong? No? That's good. Y'all are great parents then. That's good. That's good. Any teachers in here, you ever had a student do something wrong? No? You have perfect classrooms as well? I guess I'm the only one who was a teacher who had bad children and a parent who had, you know, children who made bad choices. Not bad children. You know, the most effective way to parent, and we're not going to take a survey of the kids I have in this room to see if I do it correctly all the time, but the most effective way, I believe, to parent is to not point out the thing they did wrong, but to point out who they are. Right? It's not to say, man, that's so stupid. Why'd you do that? That's not who you are. Let me remind you of who you are. Because this identity has been placed upon you. This identity as a son or a daughter of the Most High God has been placed upon you. Now, with this identity came an amazingly hard, tremendous task that none of us have been given because it was his and his alone. However, every time someone is baptized, God says, there's something for you. I've said it so often that there is a lock with a keyhole that is U-shaped in the door to the kingdom of heaven, and only you can open it. Like, if you're not stepping into what God has for you, then we're all missing out on part of the kingdom of God. And it's that moment that you are baptized when that identity is placed upon you. This is my son. This is my daughter. Now listen, if you're sitting in this room and you've never been baptized, it's 10:25. In just a couple of hours, I invite you to the Jordan River of South Texas, the Guadalupe, and we will put some identity up on you and watch what God does from there. Why age 30? I think because God finally said, go. God finally said, we're ready, let's do this. Now here's the question I want to leave you with. When's the next go time? When's the next moment? Like, I believe that Jesus is sitting up in heaven and he's like, and I said this during that art series, that he's like, is it time now? And the Father keeps going, hold on, hold on, hold on. I believe maybe that if we start living into our identities as the sons and daughters of God, those of us who know that, we start living our identity so that people don't see us, but they see him, that day when he says, go now, will come sooner. I'm not saying we all need to eat locusts and honey and live in camel hair, but maybe they were onto something. Maybe if enough of the church began to live as God calls us to live, others would know him too. That's my hope for today, that we stick a lot of people in water and they come up changed with a direction that God has for them. Let us pray. Father, I thank you and praise you for the way that you move in our life. I thank you for your son, Jesus, who lived our life and died our death, but conquered death so that we might have life. Father, I pray that you would help all of us to understand the identity that you've placed on us as your son or as your daughter. And I don't care what the identity the world tries to put on us says we are. We know who we are because of you. And Father, with that identity, you've given us a purpose. Help us to find that purpose and to live that purpose so that others may see you. And Father, those who don't know you, may today be the day that they hear you whisper their voice, their name. They hear you call them your son, your daughter. They surrender to it, accept it, and experience the life that comes with it. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. The ushers are coming forward right now, and we're going to pass the offertory, and I want to say a blessing over it, but I can tell you this. I've been getting updates, and I forgot to send them to Ozzy to put on the screen of our partnership with Convoy of Hope. And as Helene has moved through, they're launched in Perry, Florida is where they are. And our guy Ricky sent me some emails or some videos about what's going on, the destruction that has come through. And there's just this awesome sight of these 18-wheelers, Convoy of Hope, that talk about the hope of Jesus, that it's like you can see the storm is still kind of raging and these trucks are moving in. Because of your faithfulness and how you give, we're a part of that. We're a part of bringing people hope in a time of tremendous chaos and desperation in the name of Jesus. So thank you for what you do. Father, we thank you and praise you for all that you have given us. All that we have is yours. And so now we take a moment to give back to you. May you receive this offering through the power of your Holy Spirit. Magnify its use that others may know they're loved by you. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand.
My Jesus.
With your whole heart and your hands open, receive this blessing.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, lift his countenance unto you, give you his peace. Amen.
Amen. Have a beautiful, blessed Sunday. Hope to see you soon.